We had quite a lot of interest in forests quite a few years now. Forests are something that we are all sort of banking on, right? We are expecting forests to capture all that excess carbon for us and to hold on to the carbon that they already have. Forests, you know, trees and their soils. In most countries, there is a lot of focus on trying to keep forests or increase the forest area for carbon capture purposes and also for biodiversity. And fungi are very much involved in all of that. They don't get a lot of attention, a lot of discussion, but they are an integral part. And so that's sort of what we've been focusing on. So there are some really big changes that we've been imposing on these fungal systems.
Before we get started, I have a quick favor. I've been self-funding the Finding Genius podcast for 5 years now. I've done over 3,000 episodes. And as you can see on YouTube, we're up over 1 million views on the channel, which is fantastic. The next thing I really want to push on is to get up to 10,000 subscribers, because once we do, we'll be able to put a donate button and we'll be able to solicit donations to help keep the podcast running and to also get the Finding Genius Foundation moving along. We have a big project studying anxiety, depression, and PTSD, and working on a product to help people overcome these problems, because I've seen them explode recently after the last 2 years of the whole virus situation. So if you would, please subscribe to the podcast. That would help us tremendously. Give us a thumbs up and check in the description for Buy Me a Coffee. It's about $5. If you could buy me a coffee, I'd really appreciate it. It would help keep the channel going, and I love coffee. Thank you.
Forget frequently asked questions.
Common sense, common knowledge, or Google.
How about advice from a real genius? 95% of people in any profession are good enough to be qualified and licensed. 5%
go above and beyond.
They become very good at what they do, but only
0.1%
are real geniuses. Richard Jacobs has made it his life's mission to find them for you. He hunts down and interviews geniuses in every field. Sleep science, cancer, stem cells, ketogenic diets, and more. Here come the geniuses. This is the Finding Genius Podcast
with Richard Jacobs.
Hello, this is Richard Jacobs with the Finding Genius Podcast, now part of the Finding Genius Foundation. I have Martin Bidartondo. We're going to talk about the symbioses between plants and fungi. Martin's on the Faculty of Natural Sciences, part of the Department of Life Sciences. He's a professor of molecular ecology. So we're going to talk about all this stuff. So Martin, thank you for coming.
Oh, thanks to you.
Yeah, if you would tell me a bit about your background and how you got involved with fungi and plant interactions.
Yeah, so I've always had an interest in interactions between species, and particularly on plant-fungal interactions, both from an ecological and an evolutionary point of view. I think those are very interrelated. And in recent years, I've become very interested in how the changes that we are imposing on environments globally are interacting in turn with these plant fungal systems and what we might be able to learn about what's going on below ground or in the soil.
Okay, so what are the scientific questions you're researching now?
Yeah, so we've had quite a lot of interest in forests quite a few years now. Forests are something that we are all sort of banking on, right? We are expecting forests to capture all that excess carbon for us and to hold on to the carbon that they already have. Forests, you know, trees and their soils. In most countries, there is a lot of focus on trying to keep forests or increase the forest area for carbon capture purposes and also for biodiversity. And fungi are very much involved in all of that. They don't get a lot of attention, a lot of discussion, but they are an integral part. And so that's sort of what we've been focusing on. So there are some really big changes that we've been imposing on these fungal systems, and they have consequences. So that's what we've been looking at. One of the main consequences is the nutritional status of trees, you know, the health of trees. You know, we all are very comfortable talking about the health of humans, right? But it's quite clear that the health of humans has improved tremendously over the you know, several centuries. But in that same time, the health of the environment has gone downhill quite dramatically, and it continues to do so. So we've been looking at changes in the nutrition of trees. A lot of the nutrition comes from the fungi. The fungi provide a lot of the nutrients that trees need to grow. And so that's what we've been trying to understand, to disentangle.
Okay, so what kind of plants are you working with, or what kind of fungi? Like, what are your example systems you're studying?
Yeah, so we work, my main focus for the last 20 odd years has been on this association called mycorrhizae, which just means fungus root. It's a very difficult to pronounce and spell word, but it just means fungus root. And it's this very ancient association. The very first land plants had to connect up with fungi to be able to get nutrients from the very early ecosystems. And this is something that was very, very successful, this partnership between plants and fungi. It started about, give or take, 500 million years ago. And it allowed a very massive drawdown of carbon dioxide from the air that was pumped into soils. Before this, there were no soils. Soils are a creation of plants and fungi. And it also went into some of the major fossil fuels like coal and natural gas and things like that. In that process, the plants and the fungi diversified, and that ultimately allowed animals to diversify. And then at the very, very end of the story, we appear in the picture. So we are in the last couple hundred years since the Industrial Revolution, we started to reverse that process. So we release carbon back into the air in an astonishing speed. So that is obviously having unwanted consequences, let's say.
Well, what do you mean plants and fungi created soil? How? And do we see evidence of that today?
Right. So yeah, they did it, and they continue to do so. So at the very beginnings, there was a lot of life in the oceans, really big, complex organisms. But on land, there were these, you know, sort of biofilms and, you know, crusts on surfaces, but it was all very shallow. So these were these microbial dominated systems, and fungi would have been there. There was a very long delay, about 70 million years or so, before plants were able to get onto land. And then you start getting larger plants over time, you know, things like grasses and shrubs and trees. That is quite a difficult process, but it was eventually sort of cracked. And the secret in some way to that success of plants was being able to connect directly cell to cell with fungi that would provide them with water and with mineral nutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, etc. The very first land plants had no roots. Roots are a very recent invention, turns out. So they would have been completely dependent on fungi that were already established to be able to give them those resources. So if you kind of allow that to happen, that connection, it is successful, then over time, you start getting larger plants above ground and below ground. And as plants die and fungi die, they start to accumulate carbon, dead carbon, into the ground. And that starts to build up these soils. And given it enough time, eventually becomes things like coal, you know, that is, there's a fossilized form of that organic carbon. So that's what gives us the world that we have today. So the carbon dioxide in the air was much, much higher before that process of the conquest of land by plants and fungi got started. So that sort of gave us the world that we live in, and that we are now backpedaling on a lot of that process.
When did roots come? You said they'd come much later than the...
So if we start everything about 500 million years ago, maybe about 400 or so, we started getting things that look like roots. And there is a sort of a gradual process of plants becoming larger, you know, and the first forests appearing. And forests are the most efficient way of building up deep soils accumulating vast amounts of plant biomass. So that is recent for our mindsets. You know, we are talking, you know, maybe 300-400 million years ago.
Okay. So again, when you mentioned plants and fungi form soil, how do they do it? What's been studied? What's been observed?
Yeah, so there's been a shift recently. So it used to be thought that soils mainly came from above ground parts of plants dying off. So leaf litter, you know, leaves falling down. It's what you see in the autumn, right? Where do all those leaves go, right? So that becomes soil. And that does become soil. But most of the soil actually comes from dying roots and the fungi that are connected to those roots. So plants allocate quite a lot of the carbon that they fix above ground to their root systems. And a lot of that goes into the fungi that are connected to them. So it's a payment, it's a partnership. So you pay in sugars and in fats to these fungi that will then pay you back with mineral good that's coming out. There's a physical difference. So plants cannot make structures that are small enough to get into the smallest cracks and crevices in the soil, but fungi can. So they have sort of an upper hand in mining minerals in the soil. So it is more efficient, and it's been so for the last 500 million years, for plants to pay fungi to then go out into the soil and bring them back minerals. So it is those dying roots, those dying fungi that generates what we call soil. So it's this, you know, very incredibly complicated mix of minerals, dead plant material, dead fungal material, and then also living plants and microbes. So fungi, bacteria, you know, microfauna, et cetera, et cetera. It's the most complex environment we have in the planet.
Oh, wow. So is the soil complex, or it seems
the soil is insanely complex, and a lot of that complexity is linked to these roots of plants. Roots are the main sort of conduit of energy into soils. That's how we ended up with all that.
Well, wait a second.
Those wonderful deep soils.
Wait.
Yeah.
Before we continue, I've been personally funding the Finding Genius podcast for 4.5 years now, which has led to 2,700 plus interviews of clinicians, researchers, scientists, CEOs, and other amazing people who are working to advance science and improve our lives and our world. Even though this podcast gets 100,000 plus downloads a month, we need your help to reach hundreds of thousands more worldwide. Please visit findinggeniuspodcast.com and click on Support Us. We have 3 levels of membership from $10 to $49 a month, including perks such as the ability to see ahead in our interview calendar and ask questions of upcoming guests, transcripts of podcasts you're interested in, the ability to request specific topics or guests, and more. Visit findinggeniuspodcast.com and click Support Us today. Now, back to the show.
Is the soil complex, or is the root bundle with soil, with fungi, with bacteria, with plant cells, etc., the vicinity of the root bundle with the nodules and all that stuff, that seems to be more complex than the soil itself, even though the soil is very complex?
Yeah, so I don't distinguish, you know, I think of soil as including these living organisms and these living roots. Yeah, the underground.
Okay, so we're talking about the same thing then.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Again, what is your study?
It's
not how soil is formed, but is it, what interactions are you studying in detail? What are you trying to figure out?
Yeah, so we have been looking at trying to understand which fungi are connected with which plants. It's not a free-for-all. There's been 500 million years of optimization in the systems. So there are a lot of fungi out there, and there are a lot of plants out there. There are certain combinations that are most suited to certain environments, in certain soil types, in certain climates, certain, you know, amounts of water, etc. So this has been very finely optimized, and we are very much still in the early days of understanding what is where and why. You know, this is not received investment that, let's say, you know, biomedical investigations have received. So there's a lot to learn still. So we are trying to understand who's there, what they're doing. We are trying to understand how mainly the cycles of carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus, which are the 3 major biogeochemical cycles, which we are also the main cycles that we are disturbing, how they are responsible for these changes with these different plant and fungi in different locations. So there are soils that are deeper than other soils. There are soils that have more carbon than others. A lot of that has to do with which particular combinations of plants and fungi are there. I mean, it's obvious, right? They've been around there for a long time. They're the masters of generating these soils. And so we need to know who's doing what where, and then how that is changing as we add more carbon, more nitrogen, and more phosphorus to those systems as we try to sort of accelerate them to increase productivity or whatever it is that we're trying to do. What are the consequences of that on those biological components, the plants and the fungi that are already there and that are being impacted. And they are impacted massively. So there are huge shifts in which species of fungi are dominant in different soils. As you change them, you get huge gradients, you know, as you go from, for instance, across different parts of Europe, areas that are more polluted to areas that are less polluted, massive changes in which fungi are doing what. And we've pushed a lot of these systems into conditions that they didn't evolve for. They've never experienced in those 500 million years of experiments that they did. We've created conditions that they have never, ever experienced. So it is trying to understand what are the results of those new experiments that we're doing.
Well, again, what new experiments? What are you looking at?
Yeah, so a lot of this has to do with extraordinary amounts of nitrogen that we are adding to forests, for instance. This is not just about runoff from agriculture. A lot of this is atmospheric deposition. So it's in ions that are coming in with the rain or the snow. And that one of the things that it's doing is that it's shifting a lot of these forests into conditions that they've never experienced before. Things that, for instance, being limited by phosphorus. This is something that is very unusual in these kinds of European forests, and it's something that we are responsible for. So that has consequences, and we are trying to understand what the consequences of that are. Because, as I said at the beginning, we are very much banking on forests continuing to hold on to carbon and hopefully take up more carbon, but they're having to do it in under conditions that they've never experienced before, that the plants and the fungi that do that business have never experienced before. So there's a fair amount of things that we need to sort out.
Have you compared regenerative farming versus traditional farming, where they're putting all kinds of fertilizers in, and what happens to the soil locally?
Yeah, so we are interested in not so much farming. We've been looking mainly at forest areas in other natural ecosystems. We have a lot of these ecosystems called heathlands that are shrubby areas here, and also in grasslands, some of which are used for pastures. So this is a lot of the land. This is a lot of the land where we hope that we can keep and store more carbon. A lot of the agricultural land is really quite degraded, and it has a net loss of carbon already, and it has had that for quite a long time. So we've been trying to focus on these natural ecosystems that we still have and what the impacts are there. So there's a lot of interest in doing this sort of assessments of what the carbon stocks are across different systems. I mean, you know, I should backtrack a little bit. You know, there is tremendous focus on the above ground. There is a tremendous focus on disease, natural ecosystems and pests. There's a tremendous focus on bacterial processes, rather limited focus on the underground, on the soil systems, and there's quite a limited focus on the fungi, or there's been so far. So a lot of what we're trying to do is sort of fill in the gaps in the knowledge so that we can be in a better position to understand how the systems work and then take steps to manage them appropriately.
Okay. So again, what are you seeing in forest systems? Are you looking at ones that are being cut down, or you're just looking at ones that are just, you know, kind of going along?
Yeah. Yeah. We are looking at the range. So forests that are protected for conservations that are not logged, and also forests that are sort of working forests, you know, the ones that we plant and we harvest like a crop. And surprisingly, across all of the patterns are actually quite similar. So as you have forests in areas that are receiving more pollution, so this is more carbon and also more nitrogen, then you are getting losses in the diversity of the fungi and shifts in the diversity. So in most of these forests, before we started, let's say, messing with the atmosphere, the fungi that were very dominant there were essentially superb at mining. So they would go very far away from roots, they would pump a lot of carbon into the soil, and then they would try to extract mineral nutrients. We've shifted them into the systems where the fungi are, let's say, lazier. So they don't go as far, almost not very far from the roots at all, and they are not as good at mining for minerals, and they're also not very good at pumping carbon into the soil. So we've kind of created a forest that is sort of the opposite of what we are actually hoping that forests would be like. So this is reason for concern. And this is why I'm arguing that we need to, you know, understand how the systems actually work and make less assumptions about, you know, it's all about the above ground or it's all run by bacteria. There are other things going on.
Well, what's the, I don't know, what are some future experiments that you're looking to do? Maybe you haven't gotten to them yet. I don't know.
Yeah. So the kinds of experiments that we are trying to do, and it's always a huge struggle to convince people that it's worth looking at fungi and it's worth looking at the soil. We have trial plantations. We are inoculating trees with fungi that come from woodlands to see if we can actually ensure that they will capture as much carbon as possible. This may not be optimal in a lot of forests because of the conditions that we created. We're also trying to set up experiments to understand how this business of being limited by phosphorus. So, you know, basically trees becoming nutritionally unbalanced. Yeah. So they will have too much, you know, it's like when you go to the doctor, right? And you get a blood test. And it tells you that some things are in the red and some things are in the green and some things are fine. You can do similar things with trees. So you can collect leaves and you can do a chemical analysis and you can check it against references or standards that are considered healthy. And you can say, okay, well, these trees are having some problems with this particular mineral nutrient. So you can do that. And we can find that there are many forests, in fact, most of our forests now, nutritional imbalances. So they have too much of something or too little of something else. So we are trying to set up experiments to understand how do the fungi fit into that picture. Because ultimately, those minerals come from fungi. Fungi deliver them to the cells of these trees. So we are, that's the aim. To try to understand what controls the nutrition of the trees. A lot of work has been done on lab settings, but these are very, very restrictive. And I've done some of those experiments as well, but they are very restrictive. You know, it's not the same to work on a little baby tree as to work on an adult tree in the forest. It's much more complex out there. It's much more real. And also a lot of these fungi, they are, because they're so, you know, they're symbiosis, you know, they're these very old partnerships, they're very hooked onto the trees. So it's incredibly difficult to get them to perform or to grow for you in a lab setting. They will only grow in natural ecosystems. So the experiments that you can do in a control setting in a lab sometimes may be very elegant, but they're not very realistic about what might be going on in the field. So that's been our focus, to try to do or set up analysis that inform us about what's going on in nature.
Okay, well, very good. What's the best place for people to learn more about your work? Where can they go to see it and see your experiments?
Well, they can get in touch and find out more. Happy to send people. We've written articles that are for a general audience. We don't just write obscure scientific articles. But we've set up experiments in various locations. So get in touch and we can talk more about it for sure.
Well, very good, Martin. Thank you for coming on the podcast. I appreciate it.
Lovely. Thanks to you.
If you like this podcast, please click the link in the description to subscribe and review us on iTunes. You've been listening to the Finding Genius Podcast with Richard Jacobs. If you like what you hear, be sure to review and subscribe to the Finding Genius Podcast on iTunes or wherever you listen to podcasts. And want to be smarter than everybody else? Become a premium member at findinggeniuspodcast.com. This podcast is for information only. No advice of any kind is being given. Any action you take or don't take as a result of listening is your sole responsibility. Consult professionals when advice is needed.